how do you mentally keep yourself sane as you go through all of the ups and downs of it? Because even the ups can be overwhelming.
Yeah, I think that's probably one of the biggest challenges I think as sportsmen we face, is how you kind of manage that space from a media point of view, your social media, I guess all media of those likes. Everyone has an opinion out of there, some valid, some not so valid. I think for me, I've learned not to personalize things, not to make everything about yourself. I think as much as people have opinions out there, sometimes those opinions is just a more reflection of themselves, where they are.
702.
The upside of failure.
Sometimes failure is the foundation of greatest success stories.
Lebogile Mabotja, today I'm exceptionally excited for what is to come. The upside of failure, an entire hour with the South African international cricketer and current captain of the South African cricket team in tests and ODI cricket. Yo, the man is in the building, Mr. Themba Bavuma, and we look forward to all of your questions. Give us a call, 011-883-0702, your SMSs 31702, your tweets at Relebogile M at Radio 702 using the hashtag 702 afternoons and the WhatsApp line 072-702-1702.
702.
The upside of failure.
Proof that a setback can lead to a step forward.
It is the upside of failure with Themba Bavuma. You may know him. He just does like a hobby of, what is it? You throw a ball and then just help you understand again
run,
what you do.
Run around after a ball.
Yes.
In the blazing sun.
And then in whiteness.
Try to catch the ball sometimes.
Yes, and then sometimes you don't. Themba Bavuma is in the building and I'm so, so honored. You have not done an interview in a while. Why now?
I haven't done it in a while. I think maybe because it's off season.
Yes.
So we've been off for, I think, a past month or so.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess I've kind of been in the wilderness outside of the cricket side of things.
Yes.
Spending time at home. That's been quite nice and refreshing. Yeah, I'm just trying to get strong again. This old body of mine needs a little bit more work.
Yeah.
But yeah, I've been away from cricket and been enjoying that time away.
I must say, I think there's a side to being a professional athlete that maybe you think you're mentally prepared for because they tell you, but you may not be, which is the part of having to engage with media on the regular. I'm thinking for me in the line of work that I do, it's the times where people measure you as if like your performance was not amazing. Oh, I don't like her song. I don't like, you know, that role she played. But there's no like a group of people sitting and waiting for me to win something and then say, yeah, you didn't win. And I'm wondering, when you became a professional athlete, what were you told about what you need to be mentally prepared for? Because I can understand why many athletes choose not to do interviews, because you're forced to do them, especially if you're a captain, straight after or before at press conferences. And I wondered to myself, yo, I can't imagine finishing to MC and then immediately I must be interviewed like, yo, that fluff you made, you mispronounced that name. How do you, I would be like terrified. So what were you told when you started out about the part of having to expose yourself as a person beyond training and playing? Like, there's this media part of it.
Yeah, I think, I mean, for me, like, looking at my personality, I'm quite conservative, quite to myself. I don't speak a lot. I'll try to speak as much as I can in this interview. So I think
I'm gonna make you
my relationship with the media and that space has to be a lot more intentional from my side. Because it just doesn't come naturally.
Mm.
But I think, I mean, in terms of if we got any preparation, there wasn't a great deal of preparation.
Mm.
As we were starting off as professional cricketers, you just kind of accepted that as a professional cricketer or sportsman, you're going to have to engage with the media, engage with them when things are going well and when things are not going well. And I guess through your experience, you find ways as to how you can deal with all of that. I think I've got a fairly decent relationship with the media. And I think sometimes you can use it to your favor. you know, as a sportsman. It's an opportunity for you to obviously share what your thoughts are. Mm. Like you said, people can see you on the cricket field or can see you on the TV and can maybe form a certain perception about you, like you said, based on your performances.
Yes.
Or based on what people are saying about you. So when you have that opportunity to engage with the media, I think it is a good opportunity for you to really show the person behind just what you see on the TV screen.
And I think beyond the part of the media, because part of engaging with the media is you talking to fans and the public. So the media is just the medium to do that and to, you know, answer questions, but you're not necessarily mentally prepared or maybe not even in the mood to be talking.
No, you
know, it's like you're not in the mood, like, hey man, we just lost, bro. Why do you want to talk to me? I don't feel like doing this, right? But on top of that, I'm wondering what mental strain it takes on you, the fact that people can have such intense opinions about you, but the difference with the intensity between what maybe I would deal with, which is people arguing my opinions, versus you represent millions and millions of South Africans, whether you like it or not, whether they support the sport or not, you're in national colors. So I think the pressure is 10 times worse. How do you mentally keep yourself sane as you go through all of the ups and downs of it? Because even the ups can be overwhelming. Mm.
Yeah, I think that's probably one of the biggest challenges I think as sportsmen we face is how you kind of manage that space from a media point of view, your social media, I guess all media of those likes. Everyone has an opinion out of there, some valid, some not so valid. I think for me, I've learned not to personalize things, not to make everything about yourself. I think as much as people have opinions out there, sometimes those opinions is just a more reflection of themselves, where they are.
That's a very mature
but not really
stance to take, because saying that it's a reflection on the person, which we know majority of conversations are us projecting ourselves onto other people, but you're also human and you get that intellectually, but there will be days where just that one comment, you're like, yeah, man, you know?
Yeah.
How do you get past those moments where your capacities are not as great and then that one thing someone said is like...
I think you're right, yeah. It's not every day where you're mentally strong. I try and manage that space within the media. Don't try read everything that has your name on. But if you do come across something, like you said, you're human and it touches your emotions, I think allow yourself to feel that emotion. I know as us sportsmen, sometimes we're told to be tough. We're told to go through the pain. You're expected not to kind of cry out at every time you feel a bit of emotion. But I think for myself, there is that toughness. Don't think I would have made it that far if that toughness wasn't there. Mm. But there's also that softness in allowing yourself to feel whatever it is the emotion is. If it means you have to shed a tear, do that. But allow yourself to feel that emotion. But you got to move on from it. You got to accept it as it is. Like I said, don't make it about yourself. And I think that's also the good comments as well. You know, the good comments as well can sometimes create an illusion of what reality really is. You know, I mean, I know sometimes you play a game and you play it really well, and then you think that you the next best thing since sliced bread, and then you play another game and you don't do as well,
and then the crash is even harder.
Yeah. So I think just learning that ability to kind of keep your emotions in balance, in check, ride those waves of success as well as failure, I think that it allows the journey to be a lot more enjoyable. If that makes sense.
Do you ever watch tennis players when they lose their ish and they're like banging their rackets, you know, like breaking their rackets, and think, I feel you, man. Like that, I wish I could just take a bat one day.
Do you can't ever... exactly be doing that, but I can understand the emotion.
Yes, yes. And I think it must be such a difficult thing to relate to, where... I really have tried to look at professional athletes, and all these amazing documentaries coming out really give you insight into the type of mind a person has to have. Because a big part of it is, yes, you're talented, yes, you're disciplined, but there's a massive part that is the mental part. And I remember Michael Jordan speaking about like what his attitude would be for every goal that he missed. And that just drove him to be amazing, whereas others that could just crush them and then they completely fall off the wagon. So we're going to take a break. And when we come back, I want to really delve into your mind in terms of just what you have represented in cricket as a black man, and chat a little bit about that and some of the experiences that maybe people are not aware of. The Upside of Failure. And today we're with international cricketer, captain of the South African cricket team in Test and ODI cricket, Themba Bavuma. And we have just been having a discussion around what is required of a pro athlete mentally off the field in terms of engaging with people. But I have been wondering, and of course we take your calls on 011-883-0702 in the WhatsApp line, 072-702-1702. Themba, I wonder sometimes, you know, and I don't know if I'm going to articulate it correctly. There are many things I've done in my career where I've been the youngest, the first black female, the first black to X, Y, and Z, right? And the part that's so difficult to articulate when you receive praise is the part where it comes with a sense of loneliness in a way, because there's no one that was there before you to relate. And sometimes the spaces are still very exclusive, so you are the only one in the space. And I also, not just being black, being a woman, being young in rooms of people that are the opposite, well-experienced, well-versed, sometimes feel like, I thought I had proven myself. Why do I feel like I still need to prove myself? And it's very hard to articulate that without seeming like you are so ungrateful. And then there's the part where I'm angry, where I'm like, it's 2023. Why are we still having this conversation? And I don't know if I'm articulating it well enough, but are there those feelings that you have experienced yourself where you do get the accolade of like, oh, the first black, this, oh, wonderful. But there's a dark side that very few people can relate to. And your side might be more unique to, you know, it's not like you can phone Sia and be like, yo, brah, as the first black, because his experience is very different to what your career has looked like. So what are the things you went through? And I hope you're able to articulate it a lot better than what I'm trying to convey.
Yeah, I think that's a good point. In terms of finding yourself being the first somebody to do something, that there's those feeling of loneliness. I think for me, if I think of when I first scored my first test 100, I think it was 2016. I think for me, the joy and emotion around it was just merely the fact that being an international batsman, I've been able to cross this milestone, you know, and that's quite big for a lot of guys who are coming to international level, in terms of you feeling like you belong at that level. So for me, a lot of my joy and emotion was around that. And I was very naive, or ignorant to the fact that I'm a black African. I'm in the Proteas team. I'm a batsman as well. And being the first in all of those points brought about a side that I don't think the system could have prepared me as well as it could have. From a mental point of view, took me a while to really accept being seen as a black African batter and not just as a batsman. I think, again, it's just that naivety of growing up, always playing in the team because you felt that you were good, you were as good as the other guys. And then you get to national level, then I guess that side of the politics, that side of the game becomes, there's a bigger scope on it. And I think I found myself in a position where whenever we speak about black players, whenever we speak about transformation, Themba's name always comes up. So being able to deal with mentally is something that it's it's a constant process. It's a daily thing where the confidence in yourself, you got to keep filling that cup. You got to keep making sure that you believe, you 100% believe that you're in the team because of your skill. Yes, we have
transformation. I'm glad you're touching on, you articulating that specifically, because we know why the transformation programs are there. We understand their purpose. But the dark side that you actually articulated so well is that there's a sense, and it's indirect sometimes how it is put to you, and sometimes you question, am I imagining things or am I crazy, right? But you can sense, because you can't articulate it. A person would say, if you say, I feel like you guys are treating me like I only got you because I'm a black woman who's young and maybe it looks good for your books. But then people say, okay, what did we say? What did we do? But I can't articulate a feeling of a tone. I can't articulate it. So then I gaslight myself where I'm like, am I imagining? So that side of it, I love how you articulated to say, I am here because of my skill. We have to keep repeating it to ourselves, because we find ourselves in situations where we are made to feel like we're not here because of our skill.
I think that's something, at least for me, on a daily, you got to keep waking up in the morning, check in with what your goals are, your mission, how you're going to get there. But just make sure that belief is there. I think you made another point about always feeling that you need to prove to yourself. I think that's something that will always be there, at least what I've experienced as a professional cricketer, playing at the elite level, there's always certain demons that you're dealing with within your head. It could be just internal stuff. It could be external stuff, things that are being thrown around in the media. But I think as sportsmen who are competitive, who are ambitious, who are always trying to push the boundaries, there's always that feeling of, am I still good enough to do this? You still want to push yourself to get to your point. And I think that type of drive is what I think allows guys to get closer and closer to doing the unbelievable.
What are some of the demons, the internal ones? Because I think the external ones are quite obvious. Some of them are listening right now. But the internal demons, outside of the general insecurities that come with being a high performer and striving for perfection, striving for the next big thing, what are some of the demons that people wouldn't even imagine that you go through, even after everything you've done and achieved?
I think the things that I experience, I honestly don't think they're unique to me. Because at the end of the day, as much as I'm a black African, I'm still a sportsman.
Yes.
We all deal with certain demons at a certain level, at different intensities. So I think the things that I deal with, whether it could be, do I feel that I'm still good enough at this point in time? Can I still play the way that I used to play? Those are things that you always kind of have to deal with. Being captain as well, you know, that brings a different perspective on things, and you're always questioning if the decisions that you're making, is it in the betterment of the team, and not just about yourself. I think that responsibility of captain, it's been quite an eye opener for me, in terms of really understanding Temba the person, but also really understanding how to deal with people, and how to deal with the media. I never had a great deal of experience before coming into captaincy. I think I'd had about 2 years, and I had good success as a captain. We won a lot of trophies at the Lions. But coming into the national side, having that role of captaincy, again, it was a dream. It was a dream that I ticked off. But again, I don't feel as if I was as prepared as I could have been. And I think because, like you said, Sometimes when you're the first at certain things, there's no one you can really go out and ask, how do you deal with this situation? And I mean, as much
and it's literally there is no one, because
in my space, yeah,
there is no one, because if you are the first in that particular situation, in that setting, hence I said, it's not like you can say, oh, Sia, you were also the first black X, Y, and Z, because those dynamics are different. That environment is different. The support is not the same. There really is no one. Yeah. Temba, have you decided already who you want to vote for without telling us who? Have you made your decision, or are you still weighing up your options?
I've made my decision. I won't say who it is, but I've made my decision.
You have? Mm. Oh, wow. And what did you look at to help you make your decision? Like, what was really important? Like, now I just mentioned the GBV thing, but what was important to you? Is it education? Is it health? Like, what was it?
I think the history of the country, that's something that I couldn't look past. I understand where we are as a country. We're not where we want to be. I mean, there's a lot of areas that we can improve on, but I think just looking at the sacrifices of people who came before us, what they went through, to get us to this point of democracy, and you know, us being able to be in certain spaces, that's something that I won't look past, and that has informed my decision.
Mm. So, in your career as a cricketer, I mean, we know about the amazing moments. There's a WhatsApp here that reads as follows. I was alone at work when I heard of Temba's historic 2016 century. I cried tears of joy that whole week, and I had the picture of him lifting his bat as my screensaver that whole year. My brother was a brilliant cricketer, so were my father and his five brothers. So it was an extremely emotional moment for me, which I think is beautiful. Are you aware of the sheer significance of that moment?
At the time, no. I wasn't aware at that time. Like I said, I was quite naive and ignorant to a lot of things. But over the years, I guess I've given myself that opportunity to really understand what it means to the people of our country, and to accept what comes with it. I think it definitely comes with a certain level of expectation. There's good in it, but there's also bad. There's also a dark side to it that you have to deal with. I can't say how you can deal with it, as best as you can, but you have to deal with it. Take that good as well as take that bad.
So there's a question, and it reads as follows. Guys, please ask Umsutu what he thinks about the having of one black player in the T20 World Cup side. Tell him it's from Ugaba. Who's Ugaba?
Ugaba. I think I know who it is.
And I mean, that was a big thing, because the country was slammed that it's unacceptable that there is one black player on the squad. So what are your thoughts? And I don't want you to share with me your thoughts in the sense that, well, quotas, transformation, all of those things, what are the thoughts and feelings that you go through when that is still the case?
Yeah. So I think, okay, I do want to touch on the transformation side.
Yes.
I think it is disappointing from that front. And it's a bit of an indictment on the system and the efforts that have gone into our game. I think from a player point of view, I think that's probably the toughest that I found that you have to deal with, in that, at least in my space, whenever we speak about transformation and black players, like I said, my name always tends to be thrown within that hat for whatever reason it is.
If only you got paid each time, ne?
Yeah, I think I'd be super wealthy. I won't be rich, but wealthy.
Yes.
And that's something, like, I've never really understood. Like with the World Cup squad, the squad is announced there's one black African player in that 15, and then the conversation about Temba happens. Now, from my front, I mean, I've been struggling with physical form, with injury for the last while. I've been struggling with form within that T20 space. So, I mean, as a player, you got to be honest with yourself. There wasn't any expectation from my side to be within that squad. But then for a conversation now to become about me instead of just focusing on the team and really just rallying behind the team for what they're about to do, that I just didn't understand. And again, that's something that I think I've tried to take within my stride as a player. There's no recipe to it as to how you can deal with that mental barrage. It can feel like a barrage at time. But I think you just have to be courageous. You just have to be brave enough to wake up, stick to your dreams, stick to your goals, irrespective of what's happening around you. And just trust that things are going to work out the way they're meant to work out. They're not going to work out the way you would like them, but they're going to work out the way that they're meant to happen. And hopefully that is closer to the way you would like things to be.
That is one of the best lessons I learned from someone who said to me, "Do you know that things always work themselves out? The problem is we attach ourselves to a version of what that means. So it becomes difficult to accept a different version that in the long run is actually better for you." So I'm happy you mentioned that. Tafara says, "Thank you so much, Relebogile, for bringing us our captain. Fantastic. I'm not the biggest cricket fan, however, I try to keep track of our national squads. Temba's such a humble trailblazer, and I thank him for opening the doors for our children by showing the world that black South Africans can also be as brilliant in batting as they are in bowling and hold their own against the best in the world." I am wondering, because when we come back, we're going to get very personal, but what lessons have you taken from being a professional athlete in the cricket space that you've implemented in your life? Is it discipline? Is it to have a thicker skin? What is it that no other place but cricket could have taught you about life?
I think discipline is definitely one of them. Trust in yourself, even when things don't look good, things don't look rosy. You got to trust in yourself. If it means that you got to trick yourself, do that. But you got to have full trust in your ability. And like I said, just accepting things that will happen the way that they're meant to be. But I mean, there's a lot of lessons. But at the moment, those are probably the two that kind of stick out. Maybe because they're super relevant to me at this point in time.
When we won the World Cup the second time and we were all very stressed, some people were drinking and taking anti-anxiety meds because of that game. And I'm wondering, when you're a professional athlete in a different sport, but you're also a national citizen, what did that moment feel like for you? Because there are so many layers from your perspective that we as South Africans would never have. It's understanding the pressure on the captain. It's understanding what it would mean for a country. What does it feel like when you are watching? Because they are parallels, but also you are just a person like me screaming at the TV and being like, no.
No, the Springbok story is inspiring. We were there as a team in India. We were all in one room watching the game. I think just seeing the way the guys went through the pressure moments and how they, we always speak about always find a way, whatever is in front of you, always find a way. And it's one thing when you speak about it, but when you see it actioning itself, you know, it hits you differently. So that was quite inspiring, watching the Springboks and them again lifting that cup. And it's definitely energy that we try to take and put into our game. Unfortunately, we weren't able to mimic their efforts, but we definitely took a lot of confidence a lot of belief in the way that they went about their business.
Do you find that the comparisons are hard? Where, I mean, even on my show, it, like, every time the Springboks achieve something, then they mention Proteas, and then... So I simply ask the listeners, you know, guys, if we're going to have this honest conversation, why can't we keep this national pride for all the teams? And I use the scenario to say, if you have three children, one is the Springbok, one is the Protea, and one is Bafana, and Bafana is struggling, which child needs more attention of the three? Mm. Which child needs more love? Which child needs? And people were so emotional by me asking the question the way that I did. And I'm wondering from your perspective, because it's not just your personal name that gets brought up, but the team. Yeah, well, we can support the Springboks because they perform, but we'll support when people perform. Like, no, 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 let's bring it back to the child scenario. You actually support when your child is not performing. That's when the school calls you in. They don't call you in when your kid gets 95%. They call you in to say, we're concerned, what can we do to support? I don't know what your thoughts are on that in terms of the kind of support as a country that we could be giving even in bad seasons. I mean, there's a match that you recently just lost, but I'm like, that's actually when the support is needed, not just at the winning times.
I think that relationship with your fans, it's a very emotional one. And I don't think the fans would look at it as maturely as you put it.
In terms of, maybe I'm being mature about it because I'm not a... Like, I'm not ripping seats out of a stadium. I didn't bet money, bet my house. So it's not that deep for me. So I don't want to take away from the fans and be like, you guys are not being that mature. Maybe they're just heavily invested in a different way. I'm speaking as somebody who's like, well, as a mother, I'm just considering, here's a thought.
It's definitely emotionally driven. And I think as a Proteas team, I mean, that... I mean, we've never won a World Cup, right? We're gonna deal with what comes with that until we win the World Cup. So, I mean, that's something that I've accepted. That's something that a lot of the guys within the team has accepted. And I mean, there will be opportunities, like the guys are now going to the T20 World Cup to do what hasn't been done. But until then, we'll have to deal with whatever comes with it. Individually, you'll have to deal with whatever comes with. Is it fair? At times, it can feel unfair. I think not a lot of teams at the moment can be compared to the Springboks and their heroics and what they have done.
Except for the sheep shearing guys, we can.
There's not a lot of many back-to-back winning captains out there, so. You know, if you find yourself being compared to Sia, I think you should pat yourself on the back. I mean, people see something worthy enough to throw your name in the same sentence as him. But yeah, as a Proteas team, as a player, unfortunately for now, we're gonna have to deal with that that criticism, that choker's tag, you know, that comes with the team until we do what we know we can do.
So let me speak it into the universe. When we win, are you going to come back to the show to talk about it with me?
I'll definitely come back.
There we go.
Afternoon, Kilebogile. Many years ago, about 2 decades ago, I was in the sports marketing sponsorship space, and cricket was one of our products. And I remember a very subtly heated discussion around quotas in cricket and how they were disadvantaging the national team. And my question was, or rather my response was, I totally agree. We do not need coaches. People should make it there because they've earned it. How do the white players know they've earned it when they've never had to compete against the rest, but the system gives them the kind of privilege that isolates them and makes them look excellent because they're isolated and they get to set the pace? How do they know that they're there because they deserve it when you have not competed with everyone else? Temba, my child, you're worth it for being there.
Wow. I'm even emotional just thinking about what she said. How do you know you're the best if you've never actually had to compete against everybody? Yo, okay, I'm going to get your feedback now. We've got Emily Mandela on the line. Very quickly, go ahead with your question.
No, just a quick one. I just wanted to check. I've actually found it very interesting. Someone raised it with me recently that actually many kids are moving away from cricket and opting for things like water polo, hockey and rugby. And they actually made the point and they asked me a question as to which heroes do I know that currently play for the South African cricket team. And beyond Temba and Kagiso, who come to mind immediately, unlike when I was growing up, when there were people like Jonty Rose, Brian McMillan, Makhaya Ntini, and so on. There was much more interest in cricket then. So I wanted to check from Temba what he thinks needs to be done to once again promote the sport, because the person I was with was raising a point that people follow heroes in sport and not necessarily the sport. And seemingly South African cricket currently is missing the heroes, and as such, interest in the sport is actually dying as opposed to all the other sports that are there. Thanks.
That's so, yo, Ayman, 702 Lenders, live powerful. And the last question, Len is asking, as a team going to the World Cup, do you, as a team, discuss the chokers tag and how do you deal with brushing it off? So three questions and less than a minute to answer.
Start with the last one. You'll have to remind me the other ones. The chokers tag, that's definitely something that we speak about as a team, as a group. I think that conversation, it's always one that is effective when guys are honest about, I guess, your feelings, where your emotions are at when you get into the pressure moments. And I think, like I said, because we haven't gotten into a final, that tag will always be there until we get over that. But that's definitely something that we do speak about.
The other one was to say, is cricket dying because basically we don't have heroes? How can we get that thing back where kids are now looking at other sports because they follow heroes and not necessarily the sport?
Yeah, that's a, you know, I've never felt cricket was dying per se, maybe because I'm so immersed in the actual sport in itself. What I have seen is that the stadiums are not as full as they used to, so maybe that's a clear indication as to where people's interests are in the game. I think that starting to highlight all the positive stories within the game, I think that will bring about some positive sentiment about the team. Speaking about guys like Kagiso Rabada and his heroics at an international level, I think a lot more can be done about that. I think our players are also, sometimes you feel as if you're a lot more celebrated outside of South Africa. So I know the guys, when they go to India, they get treated as if they walk on water type of thing. When you come back to South Africa, you feel a bit of a difference there. But then again, you know, it's all about winning. So I think as a South African team, the more and more we do the winning bit, the more and more that love will keep coming.
When you come back, because the team has won, we'll talk about marriage, fatherhood, and the importance of tradition in your life. Temba Bavuma, thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
702.
The upside of failure.
Sometimes failure is the foundation of greatest success stories.